Well, I guess we should. I just have a few comments about the day, and while Phil is Phil's getting a tyrannical timer ready. Phil, how's it going? Yeah, okay. So we don't need the timer just yet, but we will very shortly. So today's going to be, we're into speed talk territory today. Well, especially for the project and program leaders. We have 18 minutes for presentation and discussion per project. So, and we have no luxury at the end of the day to go into our open time or our free time, because they have to reconfigure the room at 5 o'clock for tomorrow's activities. So we have to be out of here at 5. So we're, I'm going to have to be very abrupt and rude, I'm afraid, with time limits, or we're not actually going to get everything done. There's a little more time to discuss regional groups. We'll have half-hour blocks, but still, it's we're going to have to be quite regimented to get through it. So, the first set of projects and program presentations begins with instead. And if I guess if I could have it loaded, Phil, and even if you don't have the timer ready yet for me, I'll try to self-discipline, keep to 8 minutes. You can please, yeah, make sure that I'm be ruthless. So, I have not yet used this thing. Oh, here we go. Where do I point this to get it to advance? It worked! Okay, so, instead is one of five of the larger projects. We call them programs to differentiate them from smaller team projects in the website. But as you'll see, they're actually projects for purposes of our application to FRQSC, the Quebec Funding Agency. So, Indigenous Stewardship of Environment and Alternative Development. And this is our original diagram. You'll see that it's looks quite familiar. It's congruent to what evolved out of instead as the larger global project. It's virtually identical, with the exception of the archaeological, sacred, and ceremonial sites, cultural heritage protection. Access. We did have a group of archaeologists involved with the original instead application, but as things have evolved, we think that that at least will not remain as an access, as a separate access. But it certainly remains part of the representation configuration of community-based conservation efforts, protected areas, and so on, sacred ceremonial sites, the whole place names and landscape or cultural narrative landscapes aspect remains very much part of what we're doing. As I've mentioned, we're going for renewal of instead at the same time that we are applying for renewal of CICADA. Instead is already in an operational mode, and so this is an operations renewal, whereas CICADA is stepping up from emergence to operations. And we have to think about our axes. what our axes are going to be, whether we're going to retain this congruence with the cicada diagram, and instead is simply the Americas installment of the larger cicada project, or whether we perhaps, and we're discussing this, and this is something for discussion, we should focus more strictly on resource extractive conflicts and community-based conservation initiatives. Of course, these other elements are still there, but that's our alternative, kind of in terms of conceptually how we present ourselves. And just to in the interest of time, go through all of the original researchers. A number of the original partners are represented at this meeting. Others were at the October meeting. And we will be adding partners, certainly new partners from the Americas to our instead application for renewal. These are guidelines from the funding agency. The grant is intended for the coordination of research projects that support the scientific program. It provides infrastructure funding, not research funding. I've talked about that a bit already. The scientific program must have thematic research areas, specific axes, and several research projects that are active or will be developed and must be funded through other sources, either currently or projected to be funded from other sources, which means we are committing in our application to look for money for projects that we feel are required to fulfill our mission. The grant is meant as complementary funding to finance collaborations that are already in place. Funding in kind, yes, we can make that case. As a project in renewal, we need to show that we have evolved over time. That's not too hard. We've generated this whole cicada thing out of the original instead project. So I think we're going to look fairly good in terms of having produced something interesting for the taxpayers' money. This is just a conceptual diagram of what a scientific program looks like. Instead, in the parlance of FRQSC, is a program comprised of axes, and attached to each axis are projects. So the projects are not directly funded as research projects, although they're supported as part of our team infrastructure. And this is a similar design, incidentally, for cicada, except that cicada is called not a program, but a network or a regroupement, a center in our case, which is one category of network. So this is when I asked about input on projects yesterday, you know, those are the projects that I was talking about. That's where they fit in the design of the granting agency, and we have to address individual projects as part of our application. I'm seeing 11:13. That means I've used almost 7 minutes. Okay. We have operational funding, as I mentioned already, and we're going for renewal, and our maximum is, our maximum under this program is, $119,000 per year when you include some of the various elements that we will be able to add on to our application, because we are an interregional team, because we are involved in knowledge mobilization. Essentially, we will find the rationale to apply for the maximum. And these are guidelines from our research grants office, healthy teams grow and evolve, we will be adding new members. We have to provide a progress report of what we have achieved in our program so far. We have to show added value. Collaboration and visibility are expected to broaden, including beyond our existing team, internationally. I think we do well in relation to all of those categories. So that's back to the original slide, and that's it. So in the limited time we have for discussion, what appears on the comfort, you call it a comfort screen? A comfort monitor. It's not a comfort monitor. It's an anxiety-producing monitor, and so there's a red bar there at this point. But I think it's going to be set up in such a way that you have green for your 8 minutes, and then it will turn to yellow for discussion period. And if you see red, that's it. So we've got 10 minutes, or a little less than 10 minutes. And I think, I wonder if there are thoughts on the question strategically of whether we should pitch this as really the America's installment of CICADA with respect to our axis configuration, or whether there would be some value in a stricter focus on resource extraction and community-based conservation responses. Still with a lot of the same conceptual context, but yeah, Mario.
There you go. I guess that it will depend also in part on how are we defining extractivism. Resource extraction. Are we just talking about mining?
Well, not at all. I think when I take stock of our partners, Indigenous partners in the Americas, our current engagements are mining, hydroelectricity, forestry as our primary concerns. And then, of course, if we're dealing with conservation and community-based protected area initiatives and so on, we're also dealing with excisions, park and protected area excisions by the state, which are another form of extraction. So I think I would see all of those as bundled in even the narrower focus. They're obviously going to be there in the broader focus as well. But
and you think, this in the context of making instead more narrow, in order that it doesn't replicate CICADA. Obviously.
We're going to have to show that there's a, what is it? It fundamentally comes down to, we have to show we're not double dipping at the level of funding. So I think it's viable to represent it either way, but it's perhaps a little less likely to be mistaken for double dipping if we have a kind of a different diagram, a different looking.
Because in this instance, instead and CICADA will be applying for the same sort of strategic approach to what the funds can be used for.
Yes. If we took the option of complete congruence conceptually and methodologically, then we would have to be very careful in our project descriptions and in our budget to say, this is what we're going to fund under instead, and this is what we're going to fund under CICADA.
I think that, the top of my head, I think that perhaps then focusing more thematically will fly easier and will be, make it easier in the application than having to go finding in each budget item, that we are not replicating this meeting, that meeting.
Yeah.
It might, yeah.
we're still going to have a lot of overlapping activities. We wouldn't want to get away from that.
Yeah.
So, you know, we'll still.
Yeah, but it's, at the end of the day, it's how it appears on paper and how it's going to be viewed by the agency.
Yeah.
Say, keep it as separated as possible.
Yeah, I think it is a more strategic than substantive option that we're considering here. Yeah.
Colin. Over here. I wonder if there's not a good rationale then to keep the archaeological component of the original Instead project and think about the kind of issues that come with the kind of desecration and destruction of archaeological resources in terms of the kind of things that we were talking about in Sylvie's session yesterday, the kind of life projects, the kind of ontologies, the here and now relationships that people have. I think these are encountered across North America for sure in urban areas.
Yeah.
If it needs an access theme, it's something like somebody to work on it. I could help out with that for sure.
In a way, to separate it as an access, though, in some ways. It's interesting to see it as part of an integral approach to territory, ecological, cultural, archaeological, so that I certainly don't want to lose that element substantively, but it's a question of whether and again it's a strategic question. Two of the archaeologists who started with us are not going to be continuing in the new iteration of Instead. And if it looks like we are supposed to be we're supposed to have archaeologists on the team, we're going to be thin. But I think when it comes to the kinds of work that we're doing with cultural heritage in the context of protecting territory, we're strong. You know, but you'd argue that we should perhaps keep.
It was just a strategic argument as well, that if you want to have it being distinguished from CICADA in some way, that theme access is certainly
keep it,
one way that you distinguish yourself.
So that Instead is then more inclusive conceptually than CICADA. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. No. It's good. We're brainstorming. And probably I'm going to have to, consult with individuals about taking decisions that won't get done by the end of this meeting. Any thoughts or questions about any other aspect of this exercise? Okay, so the final... A note for our partners, our Indigenous partners, community councils, regional organizations, in whatever form they take, we need letters of support or letters of confirming that you are part of, in this case, Instead. And we'll be getting similar letters, we'll need similar letters confirming that you are part of CICADA. Since there are two application processes, the letters can look effectively the same text, but we'll have to have a separate letter for each competition. So we will circulate a kind of a sample letter, which of course can and should be modified to suit your particular angle on the project. And I guess that's it for Instead for now, with 51 seconds officially remaining. So, what an exercise. All right, next is John, and John speaking also for Joseph Ole Simel, who's not able to be here this time around, and the ICANN project. Oh, okay, but Jack, great.
Join us as well now. bring up our presentation?
Phil? Can the next presentation be up? I can, is the... So that's forward.
And the little red is here backward, and this is very important.
Okay. So do you want to set in our...
Good morning to everyone. I'm John Galaty and the co-director of the Institutional Canopy of Conservation Project. This fortunately is not facing renewal. We have another 5 years to run and many, many activities to be pursued. This is a project that's running in East Africa along the borderlands of southern Kenya and northern Tanzania, which is a biodiversity-rich area. Some of the greatest herds of wildlife are there, and the wildlife is primarily found in areas that are populated by herders, by pastoralists, in particular Maasai pastoralists. So our focus is really to look at the interaction between pastoral communities and various types of protected areas, national parks, reserves, forests, etc., and the type of community conservation projects that are emanating out of communities. So it represents a way of looking at the experiments that have been going on in the last 20 years or so across this region, where communities are trying to take hold of a piece of the conservation puzzle, and they are both carrying out conservation tourism within their own lands and interacting, of course, with the protected areas. Now, how do I move this forward? How do we go to the next slide? The green one? Okay, there we are. This is just a very brief sort of resume of the actors that are involved. We have a wide set of academic partners, universities, but I'd have to first mention that we have a really interesting group of co-applicants who are basically academics in Canadian universities, European universities, and some African universities. Nico Kassoy is part of our team. Jacques Polini, who is a research associate on the project, is there, and he's going to contribute to this brief presentation. And there are many others. Colin is part of the team from a theoretical and a thematic point of view. We're linked up with an important NGO concerned with conservation. It's called the African Conservation Center. Its head is David Western, who is very well known in Africa as, in fact, one of the progenitors of community conservation as an idea stemming from the late 1960s. So it's in principle an ideal partner. We have as well within our array of partners a set of essentially land activist NGOs, and that is groups that are coming out of the various communities where we're working, and these are people with long experience in interacting with government and communities over questions of land rights. Now, if we look historically, McGill has actually interacted and worked together with these people over the last almost 20 years. So it was with that set of linkages that we went to ACC to put together a project, which is a partnership project now funded by SHRC and IDRC, which would engage a set of land rights people and the questions of conservation. So it's a very complex, a little bit too complex of a partnership project, and keeping all the balls in the air is a challenge. This basically shows the sites that we focused on, and it's some of the most significant community areas next to parks like the Serengeti, Ngorongoro, Maasai Mara, Amboseli, Tsavo, and others. And I just wanted to make a couple of comments about the sites there. Each one of the sites involves a set of people who are trying to engage with serious issues of conflict. The conflict has to do with their land rights, often conservation, as you know, being used as an excuse to take land away from local people, even though they are the best conservators of the wildlife. Sometimes the conflict is within communities, as the one group, an elite group, tries to capture whatever the benefits are. The conflicts have to do with livelihoods. For instance, the spread of agriculture in areas that are essentially rangelands. The conflict might be with the state. So these are sites of contestation. And I just, in the light of some of the comments that a number of people have made about their own field areas, let me just mention a couple of the issues that have driven our interest and really inspired the project. Let's look at site number 7, which is Loliondo, which is northern Tanzania. This is an area where the government, which had some years ago evicted all the Maasai from Serengeti in order to create that park and guarantee them the access to these lands in the Ngorongoro Conservation Area in Loliondo, essentially gave the rights for occupancy and hunting to a Gulf State consortium called Ortelo Business Corporation. And they came in and essentially pushed aside the Maasai that were there. There's a long history of about 15 years of friction between these people who are trying to circumscribe what the Maasai community can do. In the last couple of years, the business corporation has tried to expand with the assistance of the government, and this has become an international issue because the Maasai community resisted having further lands taken. So this we have a master's student up there this summer working on that set of problems. If we look at number 2, this is Okramatian, which is down in the Rift Valley along the escarpment wall. The lowest area of Kenya, an area that's very rich for wildlife and livestock. There, they have set up a community conservation site, which is well embedded within community structures. They've zoned their own land. They have a grazing area, they have a farming area, and they have a conservation area. The reason it's sort of effective is that people see this as something that's serving on their behalf for a particular reason. In the wet season, the wildlife comes right down to the valley floor and uses that area. When it becomes dry, they and the tsetse fly reduce themselves or move upward, and that produces a reserve grazing for the livestock. So the complementarity of wildlife and livestock needs is very clear there, and that has resulted in considerable community support and an ongoing viable conservation area. If we look at number 4, that's Laikipia. Laikipia is pretty special because it's an area where you have private, large-scale commercial ranches that were increasingly being turned over into a conservation area. They found it basically wildlife and tourism to be more lucrative than simply livestock, high-end livestock. So this became, in effect, a test case of private conservancies and their effectiveness in terms of protecting wildlife. Very soon, it turned out that there was more wildlife in the Laikipia private areas than there were in the national parks. The reason it's interesting is that you have a couple of dynamics. There are some group ranches occupied by pastoralists who are themselves creating conservancies, and they're trying to make them work. They're doing so with the assistance of investors. The investors come in and basically create a lodge or a tent camp or whatever with the assistance and the collaboration of the community. That model has been extending itself up into the north with the Northern Rangeland Trust, which is is following and creating many conservancies in community areas. The question for us is whether this type of conservation initiative, in which money is being brought in as an investment, becomes in effect a lever to take the resource away from the community, and rather than it being an empowering of communities, in fact, taking the initiative and the resource away from them. So it's a very, very tricky issue, and I think we see it replicated around the world in many areas where you've got basically international capital involved in investing in an area, but then in effect sidelining rather than empowering the local communities. This is an area as well where you're finding abandoned lands where people are withdrawing and pastoralists are coming back and re-inhabiting the area, sometimes with the idea in mind to preserve conservation. So those are a few introductory comments. I'd like to turn it over to Jacques Paulini to discuss the research project. He's the research director for the field project. Thank you.
So very quickly, these slides just list the main research topic. So we study basically three main areas, the well-being, the livelihood strategies, institution, resource governance, with a focus also on incentives, and environmentality, that is attitude toward wildlife and what are the drivers of changes in attitude. In terms of methods, we combine different methods. We do, of course, some ethnography, two kinds of ethnography. One thing which we call quick case studies. I will talk more about that on the next slide. And then, of course, in-depth case studies. That means basically a PhD and master students doing their research over the long term, over the next 5 years. And then we also use a questionnaire to collect data at a household or village level, so to collect baseline data and also to do longitudinal study along the 5 next years that the project is going to last. Okay, I pass quick because we don't have much time left. We want to keep time for questions. And there is one thing which I would like to share with you. How do you advance? Oh, okay. Okay, just, you know, coming back from the field, I just spent 2 months in Kenya. I want to discuss a little bit about one challenge. There are many other challenges, of course, in such project, but one challenge which I think is very important and also relevant maybe for the discussion we have here and with the purpose of building more projects for the future, which is the issue of actually doing really research that makes a difference. We collaborate with civil society organizations. We are an action research project, but it's really not that easy to actually do that because there's a, of course, from the academic side, we want to specialize. We want to look at very specific issues. We use a very specific theoretical framework. But when you are a member of a community, you are addressing issues that relate to your whole life experience. So this idea of framing is maybe not so relevant when you want actually to investigate something to make a change for your own society, for your own group of people. To make the synthesis between different disciplines is even not enough to have this comprehensiveness, because you always have gaps that you need to fill in the end. So to try to answer that issue, we design a methodology that we call then the quick case studies. I will also call that cheap ethnography. I'm sorry for the term, but it's a little bit provocative, but it's a way to say sometimes we need to walk around and talk with the people, and basically that's it, and try to understand what's going on here. And so I did some fieldwork recently, and basically that was a research question I had in mind. What's going on here? And that's the way we can stay open and actually, in the end, be orientated by talking with the people toward what are the really hot, the key issue for them. Then we can go back to the academia and pick up the theoretical framework that can help us to understand better those specific issues that arise when talking and chatting with people in a community, even over a short period. Just to give an example, a very hot issue in Majimoto, a place where I did 2 such exercises, is a subdivision of the land. So if you come with a liberal framework, for example, saying you are an orthodox economist, you will have a way to see the things. If you come with a leftist radical social scientist framework influenced by Marxism, you may have a different way to see the things. But when we talk with the people, then you realize that you can actually be both a liberal and a Marxist at the same time, because those two frameworks both are relevant to address certain issues. And when you get the complete story of the people, actually, you can put all those things together, and you, in the end, may produce a different narrative than the one you may produce in the first place if you adopt one of those frameworks in the first place. So just a few, you know, thoughts coming back from the field to share with you, and basically, we're done. Thank you. Questions now. Yeah.
Yes, Peter.
Community issues. The last comments that have just been made about, the relevance of research to actual community, what the community interests is. I would want to know how you've gone around that, because I think you just mentioned it, but you haven't gone because. This is something that I get many times, that this work, probably research, or could be some work that is not really very relevant. You know, communities are very dynamic. Issues come, like, for example, for us, you know, evictions can be there that we need to deal with, and yet there is this mapping that we have to do, just as an example. How have you gone around that? I'm sure you should be having quite a number of examples. Thank you.
We may have somewhat different experiences, but the group that we're combined with that sets out the research agenda is essentially full of the community leaders and activists, and they're the ones who keep us honest. They're always pushing us. How does this contribute to our problems and their solutions? And some of them have to do with the problems of subdivision. We followed the Majimoto case right through and provided input when they were resisting subdivision. Then when the subdivision occurred, of course, the most serious issue is corrupt land allocations and land sales by pastoralists to outsiders. So we've been helping to track that. In some ways, I think we feel that we, through the project, can provide the information base that can then be used for both policy inputs and practical activities on the ground. But our partners don't let us get away with anything. They're always pushing us, and it's a really very productive dialogue. Does that address your question? It's I think there are some very particular areas where we get results out, we interpret the results together, and we try to feed them back to communities, which is another step. Jacques, do you want to add anything on that one?
On the subdivision, for example, there are many cases of corruption. Our partner, knows that much better than us, but we could still help them to document those cases by having, proper methodology so that the data is collected more rigorously, so we can maybe have more impact on policy making. So that's one thing we can do. And also there might be some issue that sometimes they may not be sufficiently aware that we may find out as researchers. And as we do the field work together, those quick case studies, we were a team of 8 people, half foreigners, half Kenyan from those local partners, which are civil society organizations, defending the rights of the same people that we were investigating, because they belong to that community. So there, I guarantee that we are not going to slide away to something that doesn't mean anything for them. And at the same time, if we found out something that's relevant to their case, they are with us. They can experience that, and every day we can discuss it. For example, during that field work, we found out that actually there's a lots of problems with the subdivision, corruption, etc., and the land sale. I mean, many problems which tend to make us think, oh, subdivision of land is really a bad thing. But we found out that the majority of people, they like the subdivision, you know. So that was something which was, you know, interpelling for our partner. They know people like the subdivision, many people like it, but, you know, to be able to investigate that together really result in discussions, and even for our partner, that was a way to be prepared to address better that issue and think about, okay, if people like subdivision, maybe it could be done, but in a different way, not in that way. So we had to bring some nuances, and they help us to stay on the track of what are really the hot issues that need to be addressed so that we can make a social change.
So I just wanted to kind of maybe clarify what I understood the question as being is, how can you make sure this research is led by the communities? And that's, as we've said, communities like all of us are complex, and who in that community is leading, and if people are liking the subdivisions, where's that liking coming from in the example you've given? And I guess my warning would be, I mean, what I liked when John was talking about Northern Rangeland Trust being, and other conservancies being potentially a lever for taking away resources from communities, research can be that too. So how can we make sure that this research is really grounded, and that tends to be not quick and dirty, though we need to do quick and dirty, but actually is long term as well. So how can we ensure that long term relationship means it's community led, I guess? That's part of what I
mean. It's a multi-sided project, so there it has to be some coherence across the areas. But we have meetings every year where we bring everyone together and we discuss our research priorities, and we do interact closely with the community. But there's obviously a tension there. It's not easily resolved.
Thank you, Jean, Jacques. We're a couple of minutes over, so we'll move on. And next up is Peter Brown, director of the Economics for the Anthropocene Project.
So thanks to Colin and everyone else here for including me and the E4A project. This is a SHRC-funded project of $5.5 million, including contributions from partners. We're into about a little over 2.5 years of the project, so we have quite a bit of time yet to go. But of course, because of the nature of the funding cycle, we've committed a lot of the money that we have to student support still coming. We are in the process of beginning planning for a follow-on project, and I'm going to talk just a little bit about that. Also, I think there's an integral relationship. Just want to make sure I know how to use this, by the way, before I get started. Just push on that. Okay, great. I don't need that. An integral connection between this project, the E4A project, and the follow-on project, Education for the Anthropocene, with CICADA and INSTEAD, because in CICADA and INSTEAD are trying to deal with problems on the ground that are generated and legitimated by higher education. So in the, particularly in my view, the normative disciplines in higher education, which Colin mentioned yesterday, which are economics, finance, law, governance, and Western ethics, are in legitimate and facilitate the decline in life's prospects, which this whole project is about. Right? And David Orr says that the more prestigious the university is, probably the more harm it does. It's probably not, maybe that's a little bit sweeping, right? So if you think that you know, you have a good university, I would always ask Aristotle's question, good for what? And so I don't know that we pass that implied test very well. So E4A is essentially about ontology, about the nature of reality and the way our thought systems track or fail to track with the nature of reality and the implications of that for human well-being and well-being of the rest of life's commonwealth. So and ontology is an especially important topic at this time in the Anthropocene, because what humans think about reality affects reality, not just in how we perceive it, but it affects it biogeochemically, Right? So it's very important to have as accurate a picture as we can possibly get about what reality is like, and then build our thought systems on it. And what I think universities have come to do, particularly in the disciplines I've just enumerated, have lost sight of the study of reality itself and mistake the thought system about reality for that reality. That's certainly true in economics and finance, in my view. So here's a very famous, but in my view, very problematical painting. The there's no scientific evidence that this happened. But it kind of controls Western thought in an important way. And what's interesting to notice is if you don't accept this particular account, a lot of things that we or many people accept disappear, right? So for instance, in this account, there's no virgin birth, right? No personal immortality. There's no exogenous rescue, right? There's nothing that's going to come from somewhere else in the cosmos and fix the mess we've created. There are no ex cathedra moral system like the Ten Commandments, which is generated outside the evolutionary system. There's no chosen species, no chosen people, and no chosen gender, right? So this is kind of a really wipes the slate clean in a way, and I find it very, very liberating. So this has led to the notion that human beings are inherently fallen has led to what sometimes is called, particularly by Carolyn Merchant, the Baconian project, the project to take back our rightful place in paradise. This became, the sort of guiding idea of Western culture, starting maybe in the year 1600 or a little bit thereafter, with devastating planetary results. So a lot of the thinking we try to do in E4A about cosmology and about ontology is, well, what would our narrative be like if we accepted the idea not of special creation, but of continuous creation, that the universe is in the process of continuous creation of more complex systems at the same time that the whole system is running down. There are certain places within the universe where complexity is rising, which is or at least was the Earth. And how would that narrative, if that's the one we accepted, underpin our institutions? What would, particularly those normative institutions I was talking about, what would they look like if you started with a scientific account of cosmic evolution rather than the Judeo-Christian narrative? From this point of view, you shift from the creationist narrative to a co-evolutionary narrative. And what we're trying to do in the project is to then reconstruct or think about reconstructing these disciplines from this different, based on a different ontology. There's kind of a global contest going on now for, so how do we think about reality? The most influential single one probably is the Judeo-Christian Muslim narrative, which I've just briefly talked about. Then there are the sorts of ontologies that are talked about in this project, which I wasn't quite sure how to characterize, so I said they were ontologies of place and life plan. Then there's a mechanical ontology that grows out really from the European Enlightenment and from Newtonian mechanics, and which is very, very influential on what John called yesterday a neoliberal ontology, which I kind of underpins that. And then there's a co-evolutionary ontology, which is the one that at least in my view, is the most promising one. That's giving rise to an important literature. One book I happen to have, it's not the only one by far, but of interest is this one by Capra and Luisi called The Systems View of Life, Unifying Vision, right? Which I'm going to use in my class this fall. So there's a kind of looked at globally. There's a kind of contest for what's the narrative, and the co-evolutionary narrative has been picked up by a number of people, coming in part from the work of Thomas Berry, who was a Christian monk, and people are saying, well, this is really can replace the Genesis narrative as an account of who we are and where we came from, And there, Mary Evelyn Tucker and John Grimm at Yale University have done a lot of work along this line. And also the Big History Institute at Macquarie University in Australia is really sort of globally evangelical about this process, about these ideas, and they've had significant support from Bill Gates. And they are basically trying to bring the big history narrative to education generally, including secondary and primary education, so that people globally will begin to have a common understanding of our origins. Now, there's a critical pushback against all this, as you might expect from a number of places, including church, of course. But also, a number of people have sort of criticized this notion by saying, well, big history is a great idea, but one of the problems with it is it's too big, right? It doesn't basically allow us to understand our more intuitive and immediate reactions to creation and to the sacred. So anyway, that's all contested space at this point. But these are very important movements, and I think it would be advantageous in the next stage of CICADA and instead to intersect with this global contest, right, or contested narratives. And just because I think there's a lot to be added from the perspective of traditional or indigenous people that simply doesn't show up in this debate at this point. So I just want to say a bit about economics for the Anthropocene. So the courses are the first course one I teach called Big Bang to the Anthropocene. We're relying this year, the way I'm teaching it, on some material from Big History Institute. But it tries to trace, get students to understand what this cosmological narrative, the current cosmological narrative is, and how it would affect the disciplines that I've enumerated, particularly economics and finance, law and governance, and of course, ethics, how these would be different. Then there's a course in Foundations of Ecological Economics, which is the we're trying to argue is a replacement for neoclassical economics, or at least the beginning of a replacement for neoclassical economics. Ecological economics is still somewhat of an infant as a discipline, but it's a very promising place to start, in my opinion at least. And then we also have a methods course and a course then which on the orphans, right? And these are courses that the students design and take on what it would mean to reconstruct these frameworks and disciplines from a point of view of an alternative ontology. This was a kind of novel idea that came from John Erickson, that students would design and teach these courses. It worked out great, actually, because they design and teach better courses than at least a lot of us do, because they have a lot of different ideas, right? And they think of things that, in a novel ways and important ways that I think are fascinating, actually. And then we have a field course this year. The theme of this year's cohort of students was energy policy, and we concentrated on the proposed Energy East pipeline, and the students, we went around to look at various sites, ways that energy are produced, and we joined a course that was going on at Laval University, and other sources of getting information. And the students were assigned to analyze the Energy East pipeline from three perspectives. One was in three different groups. One was, how would this be evaluated from the point of view of conventional neoclassical economics? How would it be evaluated from the point of view of ecological economics? And then how would it be evaluated from any non-Western ontology? And the students who took the last option were basically North American First Nation ontologies as their analytical framework. And then, so we got 38 students. I'm kind of in a panic, to tell you the truth, because this has taken off pretty fast. Looks like it'll grow a lot. It would grow a lot more if we had more resources. So anyway, it's going to be a hell of a couple of weeks. And then we're also beginning to think ahead of how we can bear more fruit from this kind of work. There's a global emergency on, obviously, everybody in the room knows it. The universities continue to pump out large numbers of people who are contributing to this. And so how are we going to basically rise to this challenge? And can we rise to this challenge fast enough? I think the answer to that is probably not. But we have to do it anyway. So we're working with Macquarie University to probably expand, have some on-the-ground programs in Asia, India and China in particular. We are beginning the development of some MOOC courses that will be available online and also within programs. And then we expect to cooperate with a number of other initiatives and organizations, CICADA, Future Earth, Big History Institute, and so forth. And you know, one of our goals is to delegitimate this idea, right? You know, a lot of the problems that we've discussed here in the last few days come from the notion. You can see that a lot of the mischief here is that not chosen people, right? The progress is defined as getting rid of traditional peoples and of getting rid of wildlife. Right? That's the goal, right? In which we have been remarkably, but sadly, rather successful. And so anyway, we're hoping to point to a different way of thinking about the human presence on Earth that's compatible with contemporary science, informed by contemporary science, but not limited by its insights. So anyway, that's what we're trying to do. Thanks for listening.
Yeah, that's very interesting. I basically agree with everything you said. I might get run out of town, but I want to say a couple words in defense of Christianity.
Can't quite hear you, sorry.
Oh, sorry about that. Yeah, I basically agree with everything you said. I might get run out of town here, but I want to say a couple of words in defense of Christianity.
I mean,
we have these Christianity has these mystical traditions,
sure.
Care of creation, Francis of Assisi, you mentioned a Christian monk yourself. I mean... Maybe there's more diversity and more paths for a reimagining of ethics within that. And number two, I mean, don't you think science is also part of the problem?
Yeah, it's a big part of the problem, but it's in 18 minutes, I didn't think I could get sort of handle sort of everything. And yeah, there are dimensions of the Judeo-Christian tradition don't have the defects that I was pointing to, but they're... If you read the Pope's encyclical, which was a very welcome document in many, many ways, right? Because he has more tremendous moral authority, and so having him in the picture is a great addition. At the same time, he didn't really give any ground on major Christian doctrine. So I found it disappointing in that way because it doesn't really open up a dialogue. It kept the tent stakes more or less where they were. And I thought the discussion of population, very defective because it didn't recognize the second law of thermodynamics that every organism degrades its surroundings. It has to. There's no other way to operate it. You degrade energy in living. So the notion that 11 billion inherently sinful people are somehow or other going to live on Earth without degrading it, it's a mystery to me. Yeah. Charles.
Yeah, I can't help but pick up on Clint's point there a little bit. What about process theology, liberation theology, pedagogy of the oppressed? There's a whole body of of alternative things. They're not just linked in the Catholic faiths, but other variants of Christianity. So these are ones like process theology picks up Alfred North Whitehead's philosophical approach, moves in a particular direction.
He's an important link in the chain of getting to where we are, where the discourse is now.
And then the liberation theology, which actually directly challenges, which comes out of the Catholic side and the tradition of worker priests, things like that, as well as the sort of more broader, if you think to the CCF NDP, its early foundation in the social gospel and the notion of looking at the linking to how the New Testament lessons move to create a whole different social order. So, I mean, I think and this, I often find this in the kind of dichotomous posing of West versus other kind of ideologies, as well as the general kind of implication that there's these kind of ontological things that somehow are massively at loggerheads to each other, incommensurable discussions. And when I think of the research I did in France with Breton Fisher folk, and the tradition in that particular part of the world, which very much looked like the part of the world back in North Coast British Columbia in terms of the discussions of the landscape, that was an experience occurring within an explicitly Christian setting, but also with very different kinds of understandings. So I know you're doing big history and this kind of stuff, but it seems to me that often that it's and you only had a limited amount of time to address this, but it does speak to the fact that there's a far more nuanced and divergent tendencies, and it seems a certain aspect of the progressive academy highlights and takes an aggressive opposition, almost a form of self-immolation in an interesting and ironic way.
Well, I guess, so in the Big Bang, the Anthropocene course I teach, I do have, you know, considerations of, you know, I have documents written by advocates of standard Christianity, and also from liberation theology and other places like that. In 18 minutes, you know, I couldn't cover all of the nuances in this and still get the main points across. So thank you for those comments. I agree with most of them.
I'm sorry we're at time. Do you have a quick comment, John?
Very quick comment. I think I agree with everything you said, and I think it's a really, really important project. I just wonder to what extent you're exploring, Chinese and Hindu ideas of theology.
Yeah, I just graduated a PhD student who did exactly that. So, it's an important thing. And the world religions are extremely complex and nuanced. You have a certain there's a certain kind of strategic question that I think there's no good answer, right? How can you try to set up these thinking in such a way that you can bring about the needed change. If you get, and there are people, some of whom I mentioned, Mary Evelyn Tucker, for instance, in particular, who is a student of world religions, a very sophisticated, advanced student of world religions, who works in this area. So nothing can be taken away from that impulse. At the same time, I think it's important to realize, I mean, imagine what the Middle East would be like if there were no chosen people. Right, no chosen species and no chosen gender. Thanks.
Thank you, Peter. Next up is Andrew Hendry, also from McGill University. He's the director of the project Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services. Welcome.
Thank you, Colin. And thanks, everyone, for such an interesting day and day yesterday as well. I had to arrive a little bit late because of family obligations, but I'm happy to be here now. What I want to do is I want to talk to you about a relatively new project that we have at a bunch of Quebec universities that is an offshoot of a former McGill program. And this is essentially a scholarship program. So it differs from many of the other projects that we're talking about in that the vast majority of the funding goes specifically to support graduate students doing research projects in a great diversity of topics. So in essence, what our program is here for is to provide relevant money to relevant projects within CICADA, instead, E4A, things like that. So when you hear me give a talk about what the program is about, think about how you might be able to bring students and get funding for your students within the context of this program. So I'm the director of the program. The coordinator who does a vast majority of the day-to-day work is Felipe Perez. He isn't here this time. He attended the last CICADA meeting. Now, the history of this program starts with this neotropical environment graduate option at McGill University, which was a partnership explicitly between McGill University and the Smithsonian Tropical Research Institute in Panama. And there are some of the STRI facilities shown in Panama there in the bottom. This was the brainchild of Catherine Paulvin, who you heard from, I believe, yesterday or the day before. And Catherine had the idea while she was on sabbatical at STRI that it would be really nice to have a partnership between McGill and an institution actually working in the neotropics to address problems of interest to the neotropics. So for instance, the official phrase describing what NEO was that NEO seeks to cultivate a broader understanding of tropical environmental issues and the development of skills relevant to working in the neotropics. And so much of what BESS is trying to do is carrying on the legacy of NEO. NEO still exists, of course. And so I want to tell you a little bit about what NEO has done as a way of giving you a hint of what BESS will probably be able to accomplish. So first enrollment in NEO was in 2001. Now, during that time, NEO has supported a large number of students working specifically in the neotropics. That's the core element of this program. All of those students were McGill students up to the present, and they did a variety of projects. The vast majority of them are focused on biodiversity, particularly from the perspective of the evolution of biological diversity and its changes through time. There's been a reasonable indigenous component to this program, partly because a lot of this work is done in indigenous territories, and some of the work has been explicitly on issues of relevance and of interest to indigenous communities. Although that's a relatively small part of the program. Hopefully it can continue to get bigger. Now, this is a partnership of a bunch of departments at McGill University, and they're listed here. Some of them are no longer currently active, and we hope to recruit other departments into the program as time goes along. There are a lot of professors at McGill that were part of this program. There's, over the time, there's been up to 37 plus directors, professors. Those are the directors and their tenure. I was director for a couple of different tenures of this program, and there have been a lot of participants at STRI. So the key point here is that the fundamental underpinning for this entire program is a strong partnership between McGill and the Smithsonian Tropical Research Institute in Panama, but we do have many other partners in Latin America. And the key element of this program, as I was highlighting, is the research of students. So this is not a top-down directed research program where we say we have a bunch of research goals that we want people to achieve. Instead, people come to us with the research that they want to do, and as long as it fits within the broad general goal of environmental issues in the neotropics, then we seek to support that research and the students doing that research. So it's a very bottom-up oriented program where it really is the sum of its parts, and sometimes we try to make it more than the sum of those parts, but the key element is to try and support a bunch of diverse research programs that people are doing that are relevant to the goals of the program. These are a number of former students in the program. Now, just to give you an idea of what we've been able to accomplish over those 15 years or so, we've graduated a total of 47 students, 12 of them are PhDs, and that's the distribution across the programs. The majority of the students are in the biology department and are focusing mainly on various organisms in the neotropics. And that's a natural thing because we have this partnership with STRI where almost everybody at STRI is a biologist as well. So this is really a program emphasizing the biological diversity. But of course, we do have representation from a lot of other departments as well. Now, another key thing, well, this emphasis of biology is particularly strong at present. Now, another key essence of this program was the idea of capacity building, is training people from the neotropics to do research in the neotropics and therefore build capacity within those countries. And so you can see the graduated students on the left, about half of them were from Canada, but there's also reasonable representations from Panama, Mexico, Colombia, France, and Chile. And then the current representation is even more weighted toward Latin American students. I've spelled Colombia wrong on this, I apologize. Now, the problem for the NEO program from its inception was that there wasn't a lot of money to support students. So STRI provided a fair amount of money, McGill provided some money, but really it was sort of an opportunity to bring people together and provide them with small sources of funding. So when I was NEO director, this program, the NCERT Create program in Canada, came into being, and this program was specifically designed to fund programs that sounded exactly like the program we already had. Now, technically, you can't apply in this program through this system for a program that already exists, so we couldn't just get money for NEO. But we could apply for something very similar, and that was BESS. And so the idea behind BESS was essentially similar to that of NEO, that is, we want to provide training and do research in the NEO tropics, and we want to focus on topics like biodiversity, ecosystem services, and sustainability. So on our second attempt, we were able to get money from the Canadian government for that. And so what I'd like to do now is describe some of the key elements of that program, because those key elements were dictated in part by what the federal government felt was necessary for funding this program, and also what we were interested in. Now, there are 11 PIs in this program, co-PIs, which is dictated by NSERC. And these PIs come mainly from McGill because it's a legacy of the NEO program, but we've also picked up partners from UCAM and Laval. We also, this was a requirement of the Canadian government, had industrial partners, which were companies doing work in the neotropics. They tend to be resource extraction companies and also reforestation companies. And to date, we are hoping to engage companies more in the partnership in this program. To date, there hasn't really been a lot of work with these companies. Instead, we have continuing with this tradition of working with NGOs and with academic partners and with Indigenous groups, which is great, of course. We have a number of, We have a number of STRI participants as well, so Smithsonian again. There's some more profs from a bunch of different institutions. And so in essence, this is what we wrote into the grant as people applying for the grant, and we had to convince the Canadian government that there would be some monetary benefits, essentially, to Canada for this program. Otherwise, they would not provide any funding. And so that's why we have the industry partners there. So I'll just read a couple of things about the program so you get the essence of what we wrote about. Environmental change is occurring at an unprecedented rate, which has raised concerns about the conservation of biodiversity, the maintenance of ecosystem services, and the future of sustainability. These concerns are especially pressing in tropical environments where most of the world's biodiversity and humans reside and interact, and where natural resource extraction by Canadian companies is increasingly common. BESS will provide a multidisciplinary and immersive training experience that prepares the next generation of environmental scientists. The multidisciplinary aspect of BESS will be achieved through cooperation of a diverse group of applicants and collaborators who will administer, supervise complementary courses in internship rotation and thesis research. The immersive aspect of BESS will be achieved through these activities taking place on the ground in Panama. So the courses in the program are taught in Panama, and all of the research is done in neotropical countries, a lot of it in Panama, but not all. And these core aspects are this partnership between Quebec universities and Panamanian institutions, especially STRI. So the NSERC Create system also requires advisory committees, and so these are high-end folks like directors of things at McGill and STRI and companies in Future Earth. We also have a program delivery committee that is represented by all of the university partners and also by the Smithsonian and by other institutions in Panama, FAO. And we had a couple of research themes we wrote into the grant. These are basically just pulling together things that people are really doing already and that people were interested in doing and having students to do. So biodiversity science and environmental impact assessment for land use planning, incorporating social perspectives into land use planning. The core of the program really is biology, but Catherine and myself afterward and all of us have strived to have a strong Indigenous component and social perspectives on the program. And this is something that we need to continue to improve, which is partly why I'm here participating in CICADA. Adaptive management and restoration following environmental degradation, control of invasive species and mitigation of their impacts, and evolving biodiversity, co-evolutionary perspectives might be another way to put it. So certainly I buy quite well into E4A's interest in taking a co-evolutionary perspective on how humans and the world fit together. So we're 1 year in. We have 6 years of funding, we're 1 year in, and we've been very successful in attracting a large number of students. So we already have 28 students, I guess that totals. Most of them are from McGill at present, but we're starting to recruit students at Laval and UCAM. It was easy for us to develop students quickly at McGill because we have a bunch of NEO students with whom we're interested in working in BESS. And just to emphasize again the capacity building aspect, here are the countries from which the current students come, and the goal will be to continue to recruit, especially from Latin American countries, to have PhD students in the program. So I simply wanted to present to you this opportunity for funding for students to work on issues in the neotropics. The work has to be in the neotropics. Moreover, the students have to go through one of those three partner universities. So hopefully, if you are not in those two different contexts, you can find ways to work with people who are and hopefully get some students in the program. So that's all I want to say. If you have any questions about the program, I'm happy to answer them.
Thank you, Andrew. And I just would point out that only a year in, but BESS is supporting two of the graduate students working with partners of INSTEAD and CICADA. One is Camilo Gomez, and supporting his work with Witoto and Fanny. And the other is not present, Perry Maddox, who's working with Nobe Bugle in Panama.
Yes, and I also want to add that the BESS coordinator, Felipe, is also going to be a postdoc within the program now, too. And he is going to be working with CUNA around Lake Baiano in Panama, particularly in relation to how the changing fish community associated with the dam and introduced fishes have changed the way in which the CUNA are interacting with their fish resources.
Can you tell us what is neotropical countries?
Say that again, sorry.
What are neotropical countries?
Well, as far as we're concerned, there are any country south of the U.S. southern border.
In the Americas.
In the Americas.
In the Americas.
Thank you.
Drift of course. So if you do have the potential or interest for getting students into our program, we do provide quite a bit of support. So please contact me and the program coordinator, and we can discuss how that might work for you. We try to be as flexible as possible, for example, by making the neotropics in Latin America everything south of the southern U.S. border in the neotropics. And in reality, we are hoping potentially to expand to other tropical countries, in particular Africa, because the BESS program and the NSERC CREATE is only a six-year program with no opportunity for renewal. So we have 6 years to spend all this money, and then we have to try something new. Mm. So what we were hoping to try next was integrating across neotropical environments from different places in the world. And I've started to work with a McGill professor, Loren Chapman, in Africa, who works in Uganda. And so hopefully that will be a natural next application to the NSERC CREATE program.
Be nice to be young enough to be able to think about a project beyond 6 years.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Andrew.
Thank you.
So next up, Terry Mitchell, who is with us from Wilfrid Laurier University, speaking about resource governance and Indigenous rights, understanding intercultural frameworks for negotiating free, prior, and informed consent.
Did you guys do all your consent
So hi, everyone. My name's Terry, and I'm new to CICADA, so I've been really thrilled, and I'm very short. I'm very thrilled to have an opportunity to spend this time with you and to share with you the work that Jose and I have been co-creating over some many years. The slides may or may not come, but I didn't put a lot of attention to them. I just thought I would use them to make it easier for us to share. So what I want to say is that Jose and I have been preparing something, building something over several years called the Pan-American Indigenous Rights and Resource Governance Network, which we call PAIRGN. It seeks to pair Canadian communities, Indigenous communities, with South American communities that are affected by Canadian mining companies. We also more broadly look at water governance and other, and forestry, but our main focus has been on Canadian mining, both in North and South America, in Canada, and in Latin America. The PAIRGN has so far linked together 27 scholars from 13 different disciplines across the Americas. Thank you so much. We've connected 19 partner institutions across 6 provinces within Canada and 3 territories, as well as our partners from the work of Jose and others within Argentina, Bolivia, Chile, and Peru. The partnership includes 18 Indigenous scholars and 7 Canada research chairs. However, we have been unsuccessful in 2 attempts to gain funding from SHRC and from IDRC. We nevertheless have, with support along the way, we've been successful in the first stages of 2 rounds of grants. That's given us money to get together and to build our networks and to build our vision. We have the support of very senior Indigenous and non-Indigenous leaders within Indigenous governance and within the mainstream. We have a senior advisory group that includes Rodolfo Stavenhagen, which includes Chief Ovid Mercury, Dali Sambodoro, and Indigenous scholars and lawyers. We've been also working with Rebecca Adamson at First Peoples Worldwide. So we have been connecting with individuals within institutions of power and long histories of struggle around Indigenous rights at the international and the domestic level. But as I say, that network hasn't been funded. But fortunately, given the contributions of all of those intellectual and energy contributions of our partners and over time, I was able to craft a smaller grant within the SHRC system, an insight grant, which is the one on resource governance and Indigenous rights, the understanding intercultural frameworks, basically the same work on a smaller scale. We're working with Indigenous communities and scholars in Northwest Territories, in Nunavut and Northern Ontario in the Ring of Fire, and in Northern Chile in the Atacama Desert. All of those areas are affected by Canadian mining or water governance issues. We are building partnerships through case study research with Indigenous peoples and communities who are affected by the resource governance issues. So we intend to study the interactions of Indigenous nations, governments, and corporations within the context of an increasing global demand for resource extraction, and of course, Canada's dependence on resource extraction within our economy. In the smaller project, so we have the large network. In the smaller project, the one we're working on right now, we have co-investigators. Jose continues to link with South America, and we're working with Chile. Now we're looking also with some of our partners in Peru and working with Luis Vitor. Working with Thierry Rodin, who I believe you know from Laval, who will be here later today, in his work with the Inuit in the Mary River Project. The Mary River Project was mentioned on the iron ore mining. We're working with Peggy Smith at Lakehead University. She's an Indigenous woman. Some of you may know her through her forestry work and her work in FPIC in that area. She is working with us with the Matawa chiefs in the Ring of Fire, where they're seeking chromite. And if you're watching the news, it's an area of great interest for the Canadian government. And Alex Latta is one of my colleagues at my university. He's working with the Satu peoples in NWT and working with the Aboriginal Steering Committee for the Transboundary Water Agreement, where we believe that NWT and the Indigenous peoples there have revealed to us a positive practice on free, prior, and informed consent. So we believe we can learn across forestry, water, and the mining industries. So the focus of our work initially was on looking at the awareness, the understanding, and the uptake of the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples in each of these sites and these countries. However, what we've done in this smaller grant is focused in on the articles that relate to free, prior, and informed consent, really where the rubber hits the road, where the conflict happens, and where the rights are most clearly expressed around sovereignty. Should we have people on our land or not? Do we want to development? Do we want development or not? And what type of development do we want? That the communities have the clear rights to be able to articulate that. The objectives of our larger research and our more focused research are to advance Indigenous knowledge and Indigenous scholarship on environmental stewardship, on sustainability and self-determination within the context of the extractives. To investigate the degrees of harmonization between the international and the emerging international and national Indigenous rights norms within Canada and within our partnering communities, with a focus on FPIC, looking at the parallel national standards relating to consultation and consent, and where we see strong legal frameworks, we do not necessarily see strong practice. And so we see that in Canada, Bolivia, and in a number of countries where the legal frameworks are very clear, but the practice remains unclear. So our intention is to identify best knowledges and practice and to look at the processes in which the rights that are at the international standards and the domestic standards may be understood, may be expressed, and practiced in their own specific context, appropriate to the traditional and the natural laws of the Indigenous peoples on their own territories. So we're looking at practices, principles, policies, legal frameworks, government frameworks for consultation and consent between Indigenous peoples, government, and extractive industries, and how they're played out in specific and actual real-time contexts. So we're looking at the theoretical, we're looking at the legal, we're looking at the government documents, but we're looking at them in terms of particular sites. So the iron ore in Mary River, the gold mining in Chile, the chromite mining in Northern Ontario. So looking at these legal and government frameworks and practices and traditional understandings of consent and jurisdiction within particular sites with the intention of comparing across Canada and across North and South America. So the legal frameworks and the emerging international frameworks have been very strong with the ILO and with UNDRIP, very, very clear that Indigenous peoples have the right to determine and develop their own priorities and strategies for development and the use and the enjoyment of their own lands. Also, UNDRIP talks about protection of environmental and protection from militarization and from removal. But we're focusing on the free, prior, and informed consent. And I believe that it's very, very clear, but there is no clarity. There is no clarity amongst the industry through ICMM and the Global Compact. There's a lot of writing and there's a lot of policy. There's a lot of principles and manuals around free, prior, and informed consent that industry has created. And government has manuals and documents about free, prior, and informed consent. And Indigenous peoples have their own understandings. But that's where the intercultural comes. Their industry has an understanding, multiple understandings. Governments have an understanding. And Indigenous peoples in their own communities and their own territories have their understanding. But they are not working together. And I would say we're working with 19th century models of trade, and we're working with the dominant models, white models, of relationship in the exercise of what appears to be very clear international standards. And within the Canadian context, we also have a whole slew of Supreme Court rulings ending up in the Chilcotin, which also give credence to these very principles of the right to determine and develop priorities and strategies on one's own land. So that's what we seek to do, is to work with Indigenous peoples to find out what does it mean to them, and how will they exercise their jurisdiction in a new internationalized rights framework, and how will we harmonize the international and the domestic rights frameworks. So this happens in the context of an unprecedented global demand for resources. We see it in Canada, and we see it where Canadian companies, through the extraterritorial, are going out and taking, through often violent means, resources on Indigenous lands without adhering to clearly free, prior, and informed consent. So there's a new economic, global economic order is emerging, where it's around the new land grab around resources. There is a new demand for Indigenous lands, which we must attend to, that we have a second wave of colonialism or a new business model. So we seek to work with Indigenous peoples to help us to understand what does it mean to them, these new rights frameworks, and what does it mean in terms of the traditional laws of access and jurisdiction. So all of these things, and that I guess would be point number three, that we're looking at the emergence of the research is happening in the emergence of an international Indigenous rights regime, where we have a struggle on a business model that, from our perspective so far, looks a whole lot more like coercion, impact benefit agreements, we're coming in to provide you water, we're coming in to provide you food, we'll trade land for education, for food, for water, for infrastructure. When those rights already exist in a domestic level and an international level, human rights already exist. So we're looking at, from an Indigenous perspective, what does free, prior, and informed consent mean? And how can we begin negotiating across the sectors of government, industry, and Indigenous nations in a way that is not inside an old 19th century business model, and one that would support sustainable development on the terms of Indigenous peoples themselves? So what we're doing is working in three case study models at this time, and we will reapply to extend back to the 11 case studies that we were originally working with. We have an interdisciplinary, intercultural network of Indigenous and non-Indigenous scholars and community members. We're doing multi-level of analysis of legal, government, and community understandings of FPIC. We're looking at frameworks for implementation and examining, as I was mentioning, what does consent mean? What is the definition, and what are the policy and legal frameworks and practice, current practices in different settings and in a comparative manner? We're doing an analysis at the level of state. What is the degree to which the various countries are complying with UNDRIP? So I've developed a metric in which to measure the degree of compliance at this state with UNDRIP around land, resource, FPIC, and Indigenous autonomy. We are working with Oxfam's, Jose's been working with Oxfam's tool on human rights impact assessments. And Thierry Rodin has developed tools with his students on FPIC analysis and looking at particular processes with the Mary River Mine. To what degree was FPIC really adhered to in those processes? And then we're developing measures across our different case sites, and then with the intention of using them, the same measures across all of the case sites, looking at the national level, the regional level, the industry, looking at human rights impact of the industry, and then doing interviews and group work with the nations themselves and asking them their perspectives and what's their history and experience to date of consultation and their understanding of these rights, both from the legal documents and their own traditional laws. So what we've been asked at this point in my work with Matawa is to develop plain language materials of these rights frameworks and to work with them. So we've been doing that. One of the commitments of this project is to develop shared tools. So we're developing a website and Android so that people can will curate information on free, prior, and informed consent that people could actually have in low bandwidth areas on their phones and have access to that. Thank you.
Thank you.
questions or comments for Terry? Vivian.
Thank you, Terry. Of course, you're touching a program area that's very close to my heart and work that I've been doing for the last while, too. I just want to kind of emphasize the real importance of looking at policymaking at the Indigenous peoples level and working on looking at what's coming out of Indigenous law. There's so much focus on what's happening at the state, and we all know things aren't being implemented, and the smokescreen that's happening around ICMM, and there, you know, I mean, I was up against, I remember Tony Hodge in 2009, where he just absolutely would not agree that the right to consent existed. This is 2 years after the UN Declaration on Indigenous Peoples' Rights is out there, and now they're forced to kind of pretend that things are happening. Anyway, all that to say that I think the real work is within the communities themselves, and to work on developing their own protocols, their own regulation around what consultation and consent means to them, so that they have real tools that they can use, because you're going to find all sorts of stuff out here, and there's a lot already written, but it's down here where the benefit can really happen. And so I'm just encouraging you in your work, and maybe we can link up, because we've been doing some of that work to do a whole bunch of training around free, prior, and informed consent, the various frameworks that are out there, videos. Video works really well in this. People do their own videos of what it is for them, speaking to their own elders. And anyway, there's a whole bunch of things that we can talk about, but the best place to work is within the communities themselves, where they draw up their own rules and regulations around consent, because that's the law that should apply in each particular case with each particular people, and they will all have different perspectives on how to do it.
Thanks, Vivian.
Fanny.
Bueno, muchas gracias también por recordarnos de que sí existe.
Thank you for reminding us that there exists for First Nations standards, not only internationally but in Canada too. We have a framework that looks at the history, and so I think there are a lot of elements still. We don't understand things from a community level. Communities don't understand all their rights and all the legal frameworks that exist already that allows them to defend their territory. This consent, pre-informed consent and prior consent must be understood by the First Nations on their terms. The communities have conserved their language, and for these communities it's more difficult to understand these concepts. In Spanish we should use interpreters and translators. It's very important. It's not the same, a translator and interpreter. In general, Indigenous languages cannot be translated literally, and we must translate concepts, but more than that, interpret them, and we hope they will be able to use translators and interpreters that are Indigenous. That's what I recommend, to understand these principles like free and informed consent, and that's what I said to our national organizations. You want to do a consultation, but use interpreters that are natives, that come from our communities, that speak our language, and we talk about free and informed consent in Colombia. It's problematic. The government says that this theme of consultation has become a way that certain private actors have to squeeze the government for resources, and they say that the First Nations people are an obstacle to development, and according to the government, we are an obstacle, and that is why there is, well, this project of exploitation on territory. You have to be consulted beforehand. It's important. This element that seemed logical to me, and it's not coherent, it's not sane, I repeat, it's not it's not good when consultations happen. Those who pay are the businesses, corporations themselves. What will be the code of ethics then? That is possible. These are businesses that pay for this, and so I see already de facto, before everything even starts, a sort of corruption, and the process is already biased. There's some corruption in civil servants as well. Sometimes civil servants will go see elders and chiefs to corrupt them. We give them some gifts, some advantages, so that they do not act as an obstacle to development, in quotes. And so this free and informed prior consent must consider the community, and we have to work from the heart of the human being. Those who work on it must open their hearts, must clean up their spirit, must be pure, so that the message be clear and succinct and really speak to the communities.
I believe they work in the community, and we need to follow the understandings, the traditional understandings, and provide support for, as everyone's saying here, for the communities to have access to the legal frameworks, to understand them in their own terms, and for us to hear back from them on what it means to us, what it means to them in their own terms, and how we can, how to move forward.
Our time is up and we need to move to break, but so I'll take just one quick comment from Hector. Yeah. ¿Está bien?
You have the opportunity to say a few words. I have the opportunity to say a few words. All these issues were like a sweet dessert for me, because these are the issues we explore in our community. I'm very happy to hear that you talk about this. Thank you, Vivienne. In 2009, we started a project on developing standards and mechanisms for protecting Native people at the resource level. There's a very important issue, which was this mechanism, this necessity of free and informed consent, and all these years in the country, people don't know these concepts. There's a lot of ignorance about this in the country, but we continue to be unsure and not really attack these priorities. And these fight for these rights, First Nations communities and the authorities don't often know this issue, and the concept of free and prior informed consent is not well known by these nations and their chiefs, even though it's supposed to be important. But these are just little pieces of paper that we talk about. It's not real, it's just paper. So we want to work and elaborate on this information on free and informed consent, but even the chiefs don't know what it means. So we hire people who go into the communities to develop the process of consultation and with different corporations, but these are people under contract that don't know anything. They never read the convention. And on my reserve, there was a subcontractor who did not know anything about the articles of the 169 convention, and he didn't even know why he was hired. He was there for the money, this subcontractor, I'm sorry to say, but thank you for working on that, and welcome to Colombia. Please come see us. There's still a lot of work. We would love to welcome you. I would like to add something to what has been mentioned. One of the big advantages of this project is the comparative dimension, because in a globalized world with worldwide standards on human rights and the worldwide economy, the globalized economy, it's important to see how these norms and standards are applied in different contexts. And now we are in relationship with this issue of extraterritorial responsibility of states. because of the violations of human rights and violations, and there are corporations that will create these violations, and it is a problem of human rights. And relative to this project, we would like to elaborate an approach, and it's something. It's a different. It's a point of contention for Canada. Different treaties, and the second point, lateral treaties. Working on that with David Mercredi, is this idea of commercial agreements and how commercial agreements facilitate these investments and the impact on the rights of Indigenous peoples. The Trans-Pacific Partnership, the TPP, that Canada and many countries have signed, Latin American countries, but it's an important and interesting issue. With Carpus, we worked on the seminar on that. It was very important, especially when we talk about comparative studies and this Trans-Pacific Partnership of.
Yes, and we need your meal choices.